1914, Europe had embarked on the greatest war in history. While America stayed neutral, Hollywood discovered the power of film as propaganda. By the time the war was over, Hollywood itself was ready to conquer the world. Winter 1915. In Europe, soldiers freeze in open trenches. In neutral America, it's business as usual. Thanks to Allied war orders, the economy is booming. Working people have more than ever to spend on entertainment. In the sun and space of California, the motion picture industry is expanding. Responding to the nation's mood, D.W. Griffith plans what would be the most expensive picture yet made, an epic of propaganda for peace. The war benefits the American industry by crippling its European rivals. More and more films are produced in more and more studios.
I really credit Hollywood on World War I. It was an outcome of an economic situation brought about by war.
Hollywood had exploited the war from the outset. The sinking of the Lusitania by a German U-boat in 1915 outraged America. Film after film restaged the tragedy, some to frighten Americans into the war, some to frighten them out of it. One startling film, called The Battle Cry of Peace, showed what might happen if America were invaded. It showed the United States Army overwhelmed on its own soil. The population fleeing from New York. The nation's capital destroyed. But Washington refused to be alarmed. President Wilson, a man of peace, was running for re-election. The movies helped, for audiences were larger than ever before. One of the films attracting the biggest crowds was Civilization, produced by Thomas Ince. Christ conducts the emperor to see for himself the misery his war has caused. The mood of the film reflected precisely the mood of the time.
I didn't raise my boy to be a soldier. I brought him up to be my pride and joy. Place a musket on his shoulder to shoot the mother, darling boy.
1916, President Wilson campaigned for re-election on the slogan, "He kept us out of the war." It was narrowly victorious.
There'd be no war today if Mother Moore would say, "I didn't raise my boy to be a soldier."
The president thanked Thomas Ince. His film, he said, had played a considerable part in the victory. D.W. Griffith had by now unveiled his epic of peace, Intolerance. Griffith believed that by showing war in all its horror, he could persuade people to reject it. The spectacle at first attracted vast crowds, but in January 1917, business fell dramatically.
In Griffith's case, when he started to make Intolerance, he wanted to sting home the idea that it was man's inhumanity to man that made thousands weep. And he did so. He did so in the most uncompromising of terms. It is hatred and intolerance that makes all the misery in the world.
Intolerance ends with divine intervention. Griffith wanted to show mankind the error of its ways and end all war.
What he did not realize was that in the 18 months that he was making that picture, America, from being a pacifist nation whose popular song was, "I didn't raise my boy to be a soldier to kill some other darling mother's boy," had turned to hate the Hun. Meanwhile, Griffith was preaching peace on earth and goodwill to men. How could such a sermon do anything but fail in a nation that is rabid for war?
Just 1 month after Woodrow Wilson was inaugurated as president, he declared war on Germany.
Johnny, get your gun. Johnny, show the Hun you're a son of a gun. Hoist the flag and let her fly. Yankee doodle do or die. Pack your little kid.
Despite the jubilation, many Americans were bewildered. The government had to combat such confusion, had to convince Americans the war was a sacred crusade to make the world safe for democracy.
Over there, send the word over there. That the Yanks are coming, the Yanks are coming, the drum coming everywhere. So prepare, say a prayer, send the word, we'll beware. We'll be over, we're coming over, and we won't come back till it's over, over there.
Hollywood threw itself into the war effort. Even Harry Lauder crossed the Atlantic to star with Charlie Chaplin in a film for wounded soldiers. The stars raised the nation's morale and millions of dollars for war bonds.
Mary Pickford, Charlie Chaplin, and my father were the three sort of giants of the day, and they were able to command unprecedented crowds, more than any politician, president, prime minister, okay, anybody, just unbelievable crowds. And they would harangue them and be able to raise incredible amounts of money just by their appearances and their speeches and their talk, and they'd travel around. And when my father tried to join up. He was personally written to by President Wilson at the time, said, we're not going to let you join up because you'd do much, much more for the country by raising these vast sums which nobody else can do.
They not only made speeches, they made films to sell bonds, distributed free to every theater in the country. Now the movies could outdo the government in their enthusiasm for propaganda. Directors rushed out films showing troops in action long before they reached the front.
Everyone was wildly patriotic. Mrs. DeMille and Mrs. Fairbanks and everyone, the ladies, Mary Pickford, they were all rolling bandages and wearing nurses' costumes around Hollywood looking for wounded. Every Thursday night, the studio contingent formed, we called it the Home Guard, the Lasky Home Guard. They had prop rifles and they all had uniforms from the wardrobe department. The whole little family of the studio used to go out in uniform and march behind a band down Hollywood Boulevard. I marched in front. So Thursday night was always the greatest night of my life because it was a chance to play soldier.
Cecil B. DeMille was director general of famous players Lasky.
Then Cecil formed a company. He himself was captain, naturally. He had no right to be, but he just was. He had gone to military school as a young man, so he knew something. And I think he read up on his manual various things, and he commanded them. And then finally they had a final drill out at the Lansky Ranch. Mary Pickford presented them with their colors, and I remember Mrs. Pickford saying she'd had it all made of silk, the finest silk, and all the stars were hand-embroidered. And Mary had a special couturier's outfit of patriotic gray with a little veil down the back. She looked splendid. Cecil, when he said goodbye to the boys, his voice broke and he was really overcome with it. Mary, however, like a little soldier, stood up and sent them to death very valiantly. The grisly part is that some did go to death.
This is real war. In their first encounters with the enemy, the inexperienced Americans suffered appalling casualties. But little of the action would reach the screen. Only in rare shots like these could the danger be glimpsed. Cameramen were hampered by bulky equipment and a shortage of telescopic lenses. One cameraman found himself in no man's land, filming American troops advancing in formation as though still fighting the Civil War. He took shots of men blown up by mortar shells. The sensors cut them out. Scenes showing the true face of war never reached the public screen. Governments wanted films to encourage recruits, not deter them. The Army insisted that all filmmaking be carried out by the Signal Corps. They drafted Hollywood technicians, but no directors. Directors were considered unnecessary. The footage was pieced together for propaganda films and the newsreels. But there was nothing here to rouse patriotic fervor. Nothing to show the glory of dying for one's country. Audiences get tired of dreary landscapes and marching troops, said the trade press. Commandeer Griffith, give them the thrilling fact story instead. But Griffith had already been commandeered by another government.
Mr. Griffith went to England to open Intolerance and the Birth of a Nation at Drury Lane Theatre. Never had had a film open there or in that theatre. And while he was there, he was approached by Lloyd George, the Prime Minister of England at that time, to go to make a film for the French and British governments. And that naturally made him feel very important to think that governments would approach film for such an important task.
In France, Griffith, the Hollywood director, was treated as a far more distinguished visitor than the war correspondents he was introduced to. He was the only director permitted to tour the trenches, but even Griffith found it hard to film at the front. Viewed as drama, he declared, the war is a disappointment. The dash and thrill of wars of other days is missing. He reenacted the war in the south of England on Salisbury Plain. Short of shells at the front, the British Army fired them with reckless abandon to Griffith's orders. Here, at last, were scenes that meant something to movie audiences. Here was the dash and thrill Griffith had accustomed them to. All Griffith needed now was a story and a cast. He brought over Dorothy and Lillian Gish, and after filming in England, he took the company across the Channel.
We were sent up front in France. I know as we drove up in this car to places where they wouldn't send trained nurses. They were valuable. Actresses were a dime a dozen. This astonished look on all the faces of the soldiers as we passed. They couldn't believe it. And we were within range of the long distance guns. One of the villages on the way up front from Senlis was all destroyed. Bits and pieces of furniture, you could tell what had it had been, and an old coffee pot on its side. And what pictures it brought up, because you knew that everyone there had been killed.
Few scenes taken in France appear in the film. Conditions behind the lines were as difficult as those at the front. Griffith moved back to where he had most control, Hollywood. The scenes of civilian panic gave audiences a new sense of the European tragedy. The experience in France had left its mark. In the film, Lillian Gish sees her mother killed. The film was propaganda. There had to be a villain, and the bestial Hun made the finest villain the movies had yet uncovered. The young officer in this scene is Erich von Stroheim, whose rise to fame was a direct result of the war. A bit player in Hearts of the World, he was soon playing important roles. He took his fiancée to see one of them.
The picture that he wanted me to see was called The Unbeliever. And he played a German officer. And I know one of the scenes that I saw was pretty tough. So I looked at him and I said, we better get out of the theater before the lights are turned on. When we went out together in restaurants and things during the war, people used to spit at us as they left the restaurant and said, no, we're not going to sit in the same restaurant with you. And then they'd throw French rolls at him, but they always hit me.
No one personified the evil Hun with more conviction than von Stroheim. He put his Austrian military training to use and acted as technical advisor as well.
Von had a strange sort of exhibitionism. It wasn't at all disgusting, or it was naive, and well, it created that wonderful subtitle, "A Man You Love to Hate." He adored being a rascal.
Audiences were convinced by such scenes, and not only audiences.
We didn't exaggerate the atrocities. They were there. They were in the newspapers. Ah, are you saying newspapers exaggerated them? I don't know. Who are you going to go by? Who's going to tell you what is exaggerated and what isn't? What other way have you?
Producers of German origin, such as Carl Laemmle, were more anxious than anyone to prove their true Americanism. They went further in their propaganda than even the government intended. This film, produced by Mark Dintenfass, was presented as fact. It pretended to show the first-hand experiences of the American ambassador to Germany up to 1917. These scenes may seem prophetic, but the atrocities in this film were not committed by the German army in World War I. They embarrassed President Wilson. He said they would make a just peace even harder to achieve. In November 1918, Blanche Sweet was making the unpardonable sin.
We received a letter from Washington and said, cut down on the German atrocities. That was a whole new ball game. Heretofore, we had been told to tell everything, make everything, you know, they were kind of nasty people, those Germans. And we were to cut out a lot of it. And we knew then that the war was over.
By 1918, 80% of all American films were made in California. New York controlled world film distribution. Hollywood was the production center of the world. The old mother kisses her son. Oh, the
night it will be loving all the ladies who fought and won.
Europe and Europe's film industries were in ruins. The future was Hollywood's. After the armistice, war films vanished from the screen. The public was sick of the subject. But in 1925 came The Big Parade. MGM were gambling that enough time had elapsed for the national mood to change. The Big Parade was the brainchild of Lawrence Stallings, a Marine veteran who had lost a leg in action. Stallings was assigned to work on the story with director King Vidor. Vidor knew little about the war and found Stallings' stories hard to accept.
So I went with him on the train, and we both had a room together. And I was sitting up in bed at the lower berth. He wanted the upper berth. And he took his leg off at night, and his wooden leg, and hung it up on her. But he'd leave the sock and the shoe on the leg, and then by the suspender part, he'd hang it up on the hook in the room. And I was sitting in bed reading war scenes, and I thought, well, it's not all as bad as it sounds. I was saying that so I could go to sleep. And so I could sleep well. I'd say, well, I think there's some fiction about this. And the train was swaying back and forth, and the leg was swaying. And finally, the leg came over, and the shoe kicked me right in the chin. And I thought, well, it is real.
Young man, played by John Gilbert, is carried away by the excitement and decides to enlist. One sequence had special significance for Vidor, the march through Belleau Wood, a walking charge towards machine guns. Vidor searched for a way to capture the basic idea he wanted the film to express, that war means death, not glory.
Well, that particular walk through the woods was done so that every move would be on the beat. Now, actually, I got that idea from watching the tempo of a funeral march in some Signal Corps film of a military funeral march. There was no sound, it was just film, but it looked like death, even though you didn't see the caisson with the flag draped coffin on it. And I said, well, this is a good idea to keep this whole thing in a suspended tempo and a suspended beat. Therefore, it would look like death before they got to the actual frontline trenches. And so I worked out with a metronome going back and forth. We didn't have portable loudspeakers, so we used a bass drum to let the metronome beat be heard all over the woods. And actually, to see that everybody was working on the beat, we had orchestra leaders and musicians scattered around in the troops. And it meant that you picked up the gun on the beat and pulled the trigger on the beat and put your hand up to your wound on the beat and fell on the beat and everything right on in tempo. And it, at first they laughed at it, but they're glad enough to work. And when you make them stick to the beat, they said, what is this, a bloody ballet?
Battle of Belleau Wood in which Stallings had lost his leg. And the same thing happens to John Gilbert in the film.
I was strictly anti-war, and I was doing as much as I could do to speak against war in that film. And it has a lot of things that we definitely thought couldn't be shown in regular theaters. And there was a period that we didn't know whether it would be shown. The tie-in between the movie producers and the government was so strong that, or the censorship haze and so forth, that if you made anything that discouraged enlistment or discouraged going to war or fighting and everything, the government would say no. And perhaps the producers would listen and obey.
The head of MGM, Louis B. Mayer, strongly objected to the homecoming scene. Audiences would be shocked to see their favorite star so mutilated. Vidor had confidence enough to shoot the scene on a Sunday and to pay the crew himself. The Big Parade enjoyed unprecedented success. It was critically acclaimed, and it made more money than any other MGM production. War films were suddenly big business again. What Price Glory was also written by Lawrence Stallings. But the director, Raoul Walsh, was a very different filmmaker from King Vidor. The pacifist message was swamped by the comedy. War could be fun. The theme tune was Charmaine. Walsh concentrated on the comradeship and conflict between the two soldiers, Captain Flagg and Sergeant Quirt. Their fight against the Germans is incidental to their desire to slaughter one another.
McLaglen, I figured, was ideal for the part, and so was Eddie Lowe. They were a wonderful combination, the big dumb captain and the cagey Lowe, the sergeant, and the pretty girl Charmaine Dolores Del Rio between them. It was a great setup, and it went on and on. We made many pictures with them. They were good box office. And, of course, McLaglen and Lowe, when they got talking to each other, they say, "You dirty son of a bitch, you lousy bastard, you son of a bitch and prick, you this, that, you know." And then, of course, we put on the title. Well, after the picture ran 2 or 3 weeks in the Roxy Theater, they got thousands and thousands of letters from lip readers that said it was the most disgusting picture they ever saw and the most terrible language that these men were talking. Now, that also sent people back that saw it. They became lip readers.
Mm-hmm. Wings was the first film to introduce sound effects on a separate strip of film. They accompanied the theater orchestra. The United States government, which had failed to get a single American built plane into action, supplied squadrons when Paramount made the film. The picture was directed by a former combat pilot, William Wellman, who had flown with the French.
When you're in the Lafayette Flying Corps, you join the Foreign Legion. And then, if you're lucky, you're sent to Avord, which is down in the south of France, the most frightful place I've ever been in my life. And then you learn the preliminary parts of flying, and you never fly with an instructor. The instructor tells you what to do, and you go and do it. And then if you pass that, you get your wings. You're a second-class soldier, but the minute you get your wings, they make you a corporal. And then you're a hell of a man. Up until then, you're a bum.
Because he knew what wartime flying was like, Wellman insisted that the flying scenes be shot in the air and not in the safety of the studio. The young pilot was played by Charles Buddy Rogers.
They would strap a camera on the front of the cowling of the engine, and I had a little second lieutenant. I called him Van. He would help me in the plane, and he would get in the back seat. We'd have the camera here, and we'd have the battery here, and the sticker here, of course, and he would take off, and then he'd get us up 400 or 500 feet, and then I would shake the stick, and then little Van would, he'd have to get down underneath and hide, because I was now the cameraman, the director, and the photographer, and I'm everything. For 500 feet, that is.
German down, they gave you 10 days. And you get to Paris for 10 days, you go to the Folies Bergère. Paris, it was just full of military and women of ill repute. And it was a great place for fun, but it was sad because it was quick fun. You know, you never knew when, and you get sort of into that phase, not knowing whether you're going to be there tomorrow or the next day.
He got me drunk. Here I am, this little boy, never had a beer or champagne. And Billy says, well, champagne's good for you, buddy. It'll relax you. And he relaxed me. And he said, now, do the scene this way. And all of a sudden, he had me doing a drunk scene. And he says, now, do you see those bubbles, buddy? Do you see all those little champagne bubbles? And he more or less hypnotized me. And I said, yeah, I see the bubbles. Well, there were no bubbles there. They were in my mind. But they later animated bubbles and put in the bubbles. So that was my first good binge.
The climax of Wings was a full-scale reconstruction of the Battle of San Miguel, when the Americans flew French and British planes. Wellman chose a location near the Army base at San Antonio, Texas. He got the Army to bombard the ground with field guns. He had trenches dug by Mexican laborers. He had cameras in the aircraft. He had cameras on a tower 100 feet high, but he didn't have the weather. Time was running out, and Paramount's top financiers, headed by banker Otto Kahn, came down to find out why Wellman and his crew were taking so long.
And the thing had taken days doing beautifully, and I couldn't get any sun. And I just saw this thing breaking, and I knew it was coming out. I called everything. The planes all came up, and they were all in their proper positions. The soldiers all got ready. The man who was the head of the thing came up and said, "What are you doing? You're crazy, for Christ's sake. What are you going to do?" And I said, "I'm going to shoot a scene." He said, "But there isn't any sun." I said, "You get right back where you were. We're going to have sun." It took 5 minutes to do this thing, this scene. It took exactly 5 minutes. And all of a sudden, it broke. It was beautiful. And I gave the word, and you could have heard my voice in San Antonio. I had a board that I pressed buttons on so that I keep the barrage ahead of the troops. Someone came up and spoke to me in the middle of the thing, and I pushed the wrong button. And I saw a couple of bodies fly up in the air, and they weren't dummies. And I turned, I didn't turn, but I kept under, and I said, "You son of a bitch, get off this thing, whoever you are, or I'll kill you." And he got off. He told me, he said, "You know who you kicked off the thing?" I said, "I don't know who the hell it was, and I don't..." It was Otto Kahn. I said, "I can't tell you what I said, because I beep Otto Kahn." And that night, when I was taking a shower all alone, I came in, and I... All alone, it was I was only 29 years old, and the burden of the whole thing was gone. I'd licked these bastards. I knew I had a beautiful thing, and I knew I was the only guy that could put it together, because no one knew anything about it. They couldn't fire me. And all of a sudden, I got lonesome loaded. Have you ever done that? All by yourself. And then I said, "Oh, Jesus, this isn't doing me any good." So I went in to take hot and cold showers to try and sober myself up. And there was a knock on the door, and I yelled, "Come in." And I went out with a towel around me, half loaded. And it was the three moneyed men. I said, "Oh, Jesus. But at least if they fire me, they're going to have 5 minutes that they'll never forget as long as they live." Otto Kahn, whom I became great friends with later, Otto Kahn said, "I said, I'm sorry, you want a drink? I'm a little loaded, but I can't help it." He said, "I don't blame you, but all we want to say is we've got to go home. We're on our way back to New York, and you can have whatever you want for as long as you want. You're a very, very wonderful man." And with that, they went out. And I fell down on the floor and cried like a baby.
These were the bestial Huns of so many wartime films. 12 years after the armistice, Hollywood could show Germans as idealistic young men. All Quiet on the Western Front told the story of one of them, Paul, a schoolboy volunteer, played by Lou Ayres. By the time All Quiet was ready for production, sound recording equipment was fully developed. But the theaters were not. So silent versions were also released, and the film was made with the full range of silent technique. This time there was no official help. The director, Russian-born Louis Milestone, working with relatively small numbers of men, struggled to find some new way to convey the savagery of war.
And finally I came up with one idea. And it is, this battle should be so ferocious that people should drop. You know, if they're wounded, they go down, and they go down with the same rapidity of a bullet leaving the gun.
Mm-hmm. The film was virtually finished, but it lacked an ending. The front office had booked the premiere. They gave Milestone one last chance. The book had ended simply. He fell in October 1918 on a day that was so quiet and still on the whole front that the army report confined itself to the single sentence, "All quiet on the Western Front." Milestone tried to match the simplicity of that paragraph. He photographed several endings, none of which worked. A great German cameraman had just arrived in Hollywood, and Milestone enlisted his help, Karl Freund. Coming back in the rain one night, Freund began to mumble a German word in time to the windscreen wipers. Der Schmetterling. Der Schmetterling.
So I finally said, "Karl, what are you mumbling about a butterfly? For the past couple of minutes, all I heard is Schmetterling, Schmetterling, Schmetterling." And he said, "I just thought about that the finish of this picture should be as simple as a butterfly." And I went crazy. I suddenly realized the ending was there. And we realized that we suddenly uncovered a hidden treasure, because Paul was a butterfly collector. Well, we went zeroed in on that thing and went to work on it. What did we do with Paul being a butterfly collector?
All Quiet on the Western Front was the most powerful statement on the war made by the generation that fought it.